Hey guys, how's it going? It's Vince here with Mudflood Mystery North. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for checking out my videos thus far, if you have, and if it's your first time, first video with Mudflood Mystery North. Hi. I don't always go on camera, but sometimes I do. So I've been just checking out some stuff. I'm going over at the University of Toronto a lot. It's really close to my house, and I'm finding lots of great stuff there. I've also been finding lots of great stuff online, guys. Thanks for all your posts and the research that's going on out there. I was just listening to Philip and Mr. Lopez there on their live chat, and they were talking about photographs, and they were talking about the Civil War, and there weren't any photographs, so it was kind of cool because I have a few photograph foibles that I want to point out in my video tonight. So anyways, I just wanted to do a quick little preamble just on the importance of mudflood research, and I know, you know, maybe some people out there are just starting to get into this mudflood, and you know, we're finding all this stuff out. And I mean, why is it important? You know, why is it important that we are debunking the history that has been given to us? Well, my take is, you know, that for those of you maybe don't understand or have not really heard what the mudflood phenomena is all about, is it's the idea that there's been a reset, if not many resets, to civilization, going back who knows how long. And along with the resets comes a fake history in which they can tell us how things are and what we are and what we can and can't do. And we believe this fake history and our place in time and our abilities and just sort of go about our lives in the way that we're told. And it's a very powerful thing. I mean, millions died in a couple world wars, and I mean millions, like over 100 million combined in those two wars. Somehow they convinced us that made sense. Somehow they convinced us that, you know, these jobs and mundane existences we are, you know, to own a house is paramount to our existence, and to the point where, you know, we're just sort of spinning our wheels. But when you get these glimpses of previous civilizations and previous builds, you see the kinds of things that we used to be able to do that we don't do now, and it starts to help the reality crumble a little bit that they're trying to serve up. I am not the most avid researcher, and I certainly have not found all the evidence and know all the stories, and I defer to you, the mudflood community, every day to try to learn more about what's going on. But anyways, for today, I just want to take you guys through a little bit more of U of T for a couple of awesome buildings that I found and just some really strange things about it. I'm going to try to reduce my face here if I can without causing us too much problems. I might even just take me out of the picture altogether. Why not? Okay. Let's, I'm not sure if we're going to see me or not, but there's really not much need to. I'll just reduce me down to just a postage stamp in case you want to know if I'm still a human and I haven't turned into a robot. Okay, so the first thing, how's the music? Is it too loud? I mean, I know it's rocking here, it's just pumping, but hope you can handle it. Okay, so the first place of interest for me is University College. So, look at this building, number one. Now, I did a video where I kind of, checked it out, and I walked around and took a bunch of video, walked back, I talked all about it and stuff. And somewhere along the line, I wasn't recording. So, anyways. So, at first glance, now, this is University College. Let's just do a first glance here, guys. So, we have all this Antiquitech on the top here. Like, just overkill on the, on all this, on all these antennae that go along the top here. and all the things we've come to know about the symmetry and the resonance and all the resonators. Now, one thing about this building, and I'm going to read you a little bit about the history here. Okay, the University College Toronto. University College is a constituent college of the University of Toronto, created in 1853, specifically as an institution of higher learning free of religious affiliation. I think this is key, guys. It was the founding member of the university's modern collegiate system, and its non-denominationalism contrasted with contemporary colleagues such as Trinity College and St. Michael's College, both of which later became part of the University of Toronto. So a little bit of, a little bit of battle of dark and light, maybe. You got Trinity College, which is an amazing building, and it needs its own video, because I can't even think about doing all of U of T in one video that anybody would sit through, because it would be six to ten hours long. But bite-sized pieces, right? So what I'm seeing there is there must have been a little bit of a tryst between those who were like of the Christian faith and those who were like, no, we do not want to be necessarily affiliated with religion. We want this building to be non-religious. Hey, anybody watching my videos know that this comes up every time I use OBS. I don't know. So University College is one of two places in the University of Toronto that has been designated a National Historical Site of Canada, of course, along with and Nestle Hall of Victoria College. It is home to the oldest student government in Canada, the Literary and Athletic Society. Okay, so it's pretty vague here. Of course, they have a great fire. So shortly after taking power in the first responsible government of the province of Canada, reformist politicians led by Robert Baldwin wrested control of King's College from the Church of England in 1949 and renamed it the University of Toronto. So that goes on to say, University College was severely damaged by a fire that gutted the entire eastern wing and the college library on February 14th, 1890. The fire spread rapidly when servants accidentally dropped two kerosene lamps on a wooden staircase around 7 p.m. while preparing the illumination for an annual college exhibition. In Ottawa, Edward Blake, the university's chancellor and member of parliament, interrupted his speech to inform the House of Commons. So, yeah, it was built. A few years later, there was a great fire. Now, there's other mysteries around this building, but first, I just want to take you through a couple more pictures that I have, that I've taken myself. There's plenty online that you can check out, but I did go there with my GoPro and took a few pictures. So yeah, there's quite the tale about a couple of stonemasons that were involved in building this building. I'm going to read you that article in a second. So we do have definite mud flood evidence. You see here we got the low windows, but that's not even the half of the mud flood here. Let me see if I can find it. Here's a perfect example. So we got a doorway way down here, and then it got steps going way up. Did no one want to put a door right there, maybe, at ground level? No. So that's kind of compelling there. Yeah, we've got a couple more here, guys. Take you through just a few. Of course, you know me and my obsession with columns. There we go. Plenty of that. Even interesting ironwork on the door. Me walking up to it. This is the east side of it. I do believe I have some construction pictures, supposed construction pictures. Now, what I find really interesting about this even here is, if you'll notice, they actually have to, there's a mound that goes up to meet the building. It's like, there's like a four feet. They have stairs here that take you up. And there's a weird, here, I don't know if it's in these pictures, but there's a weird doorway here, right on, you can't see it, but it's beside this window, but facing north. And then you go around here, around back here, and
And it's totally obvious that it's a different level to get in. When you come through this little section here, there's like a lower drop down. It goes down a couple steps and then you're in. And I'm sorry if I don't have those pictures here, but take my word for it. Or, you know, Google it. But here we go. There's a nice little window there. Let's get it close. Is that a window? I believe it is. Let's see what we got, guys. Oh, no, that's an air conditioner. But those, those are windows. You can see them. Yes, those are. But those are. Yes. And again. But why? But why, I say. Gets even more interesting. Look at this. I have a special relationship with Toronto Redtail Hawks. And look at the resonator up here. Look at this thing. Those are two Redtail Hawks up there. I'm going to do, I know it's Mud Flood Mystery North, but I am going to do a video soon of all my hawk sightings because I love them. And this is right next to it. This is the Soldier's Tower. It was apparently built a while after. And they do have pictures of that being built, but we'll see. Well, there's, that might even be a better picture of those hawks. Any bird enthusiasts out there, you want to check these out. You can see them a bit better there, eh? Oh, just lovely birds. Just lovely. Okay. Moving on. I do have something in particular, a couple of things in particular I want to show you guys. Okay. So again, you have these crazy window wells. Okay, now I know that they were going for, you know, non-religious affiliation here. But there are some faces in this building that I don't even know what they are. Well, good look at this here. See that? Beauty. What do we got here, guys? Let you take that in for a minute. Yeah. That looks a bit Masonic there. Maybe. Okay. Yeah, the GoPro gives it a bit of a fisheye. Alright. Let's see what they are telling us on our plaque here. The building of University College in 1856-59 largely assured the future of the University of Toronto and drew it in time into a federal pattern which was widely followed by Canada and the Commonwealth. Here was realized a major 19th century aspiration, the establishment of a non-denominational institution of higher learning supported by government. The building was designed, by F.W. Cumberland and demonstrates his skill in freely adapting the Romanesque style to the purposes of a college in the New World. Ah, yes. The Romanesque style. The Romans have just all over the world. Everything's been built in the Roman style because, you know, the funny thing is, Roman style is based on a Greek style. So where did the Greeks get it? I don't know. Anyways, moving on. We're getting close to these strange faces here. We're getting there. I can see them now, but I know. Okay, here we go. Now, first, when I didn't realize that this was like not supposed to be a Christian or religious thing. Okay, so you know this, an owl, maybe. Seeing an owl there, I'm seeing an owl there. So okay, so it's an owl. But owls are, you know, affiliated with Masonic, Illuminati, the owl. The owl is coming up a lot. Again, these little this peacock shape, it's upside down here, so I mean maybe it's not really, but the peacock shape in the University of Toronto is everywhere. In fact, the Robarts Library, which is the University of Toronto library, is the whole thing has been designed and shaped like a giant peacock. So there's definitely something there, but that's not what this video is about. This video is about things like this. What the hell is this? Is this a cat, maybe. I know it's not the best picture, guys. Maybe I'll check one more over. Maybe I got a better. Yeah, okay. That actually. Okay, so there's this guy. who's strange. Okay, so you might say, okay, I know it's blurry, guys. Bear with me here. Bear with me. Okay, you could say, all right, that's a cat. Sure. Not really sure why it looks like there's another face under the cat, but still strange. And again, guys, like, I think I'm over saying that people do things for whatever reason. There's no real reason. They just make these things because, you know, they just come up with these ideas and they do a bunch of work to carve out a face like that. Like he's like wearing some kind of strange mask. What is this creature? Where did it come from? Why is this creature, you know, being put on the University of Toronto's flagship building in 1850-ish? Why? Even if it was after the fire and it wasn't until 1890 or something like that, it's still... Why is this the face that they chose? I mean, it's strange. I mean, from a Christian standpoint, at that time at least, that would be demonic. So what do we have here, guys? Do we have a dark versus light where they're actually trying to promote a demonic element? What are these creatures? And what's weird, a lot of these, as if that's not weird enough, but a lot of these stone carvings, I don't know, they just don't seem to have rhyme or reason, and they seem to be asking us to stretch our imaginations as to what, you know, what we see. And why would they do that? I just don't know. I actually forgot what I was going to say there, so you kind of caught me. Something about that picture struck me. So this is looking away from it. This is Convocation Hall. You can see the dome there. If you're not from Toronto, you might be like, oh, Sky Dome and the CN Tower. No, the Sky Dome is much bigger, and it's way, way down there by the tower. But this is Convocation Hall, and that's also worth a whole other thing, whole other video. So we got more columns here. We've got interesting sunken doorways. You can see this is down from grade. Got this really... Now, I don't know. I'm sorry to say it, guys, but this tower here, it's awfully phallic. I'm just going to put it out there. I mean, pardon the pun on that. But again, and we see this again in, you know, worshiping, you know, in Satan worship or in dark worship and things like that. We do see phallic symbols and things like that. So I don't know. It looks very phallic to me. I don't know if that is, you know, maybe that's my own Freudian issue with it, but it seems strange. And my point in all this is that it really seems, this building in particular seems to really be veering away from what we would expect would be the Christian ideals of the time, and it's even professed that they're trying to be non-religious. And here again, I know I pointed this kind of thing out at actually a church, St. Andrew's, when I did my King Street walk, but here on this building, each one of these little supports is a different symbol. Symbols that mean nothing to a church, hardly mean anything to me. I mean, sure, we have animals, we got a pig, we've got a bunch of stuff here, and I apologize again, it's not as clear as I would like it to be. But they spent so much time carving, or casting. But apparently it was stone carvers, that's what the report is, the stone carvers. And this, the snake eating its own tail. Now that, I should have it in my tabs, so I don't, but let's just check that out. I can't remember what it's called. Snake eating its tail. Cerebus or Ouroboros. The alchemists, who in their own way knew more about the nature of the individual process than we moderns do, in their own way, expressed this paradox through the symbol of Ouroboros. The snake that eats its own tail, the Ouroboros is said to have a meaning of infinity or wholeness. And let's just see, ancient Egypt, alchemy, the world serpent in mythology, connections to Indian thought, modern references are there as well. So again, guys, we have this reference to cultures past, to other cultures that are not necessarily a part of the culture that made this. Okay, inside the building, I'm going to keep going around, but I just happened to click on this. I want to tell you this. Walking through the halls of University College, you'll notice a beast that sits atop the newel of the stairs at the center of the east wing. With the head of an eagle, the body of a lion, and the tail of a lizard, the creature's identity is a mystery, and no one is quite sure what the carving represents. The stairs are often called the dragon staircase, though dragons normally have wings and are not thought to be composite animals. Others have called the creature a griffin, and coincidentally, University College calls its sports teams the griffins. Mm-hmm. But while mythological griffins have, like our beast, the head of an eagle and a body of a lion, our beast reptilian hindquarters mean that it's no griffin. Still others have said that the beast is a gargoyle, one of the many carved out of the University College's wood and stone. It has even been suggested that our beast is the legendary sea serpent, more commonly known as Loch Ness, allegedly found in the deep freshwaters of Northwest Europe. So perhaps our beast is best described as Chimera, of course. Originally a mythological three-headed fire-breathing creature, part goat, part snake, and part lion, but now used broadly to describe any composite animal. So again, guys, why? And who gave the, go for it? Like, who said, make a freaky-deaky animal and just put it basically at the centerpiece of the main stairs? And just base it on whatever. Pick your favorite three animals and slap them together and make a what would have probably taken 100 hours of carving perfection to make this thing. And we'll make it a centerpiece of the stairwell for no particular reason, because that's why we spend all our money and do all our things for no real reason. And we put imagery on things that have no bearing on the people who will use this building. But yes, man, there's got to be reasons. And why aren't we hearing more about it? Why are we reading about the history of a college and we're reading sentences that say, the creature's identity is a mystery and no one is quite sure what the carving represents? Wouldn't anybody have asked when they first walked in the building, my God, what is this? What does it mean? No. So either they did and it was written down and erased, or we never knew in the first place. That's my point. Anyways, I'm going to calm down. That's why I put the classical music on. Because I get a little excited. And that's me. Okay, here's a little hidden gem I found. And I thought it really strangely out of place. But up in this corner, this is right in the back of the building, around the corner, a serpent, a crocodile, and a what? A lizard of some kind? Beast? I don't know. So, yeah, that was important to them there too. And again, crazy symbols here. All, now it's like, I have a symbol book, but it doesn't show all this stuff. So who knows? And why don't we know? Why isn't there a list, a rhyme, a reason? I mean, maybe I haven't done enough research. Maybe I need to go into the building and talk to somebody. That's probably a good plan. Okay, so, let's see. Where we're going. Okay. I guess I'm at the end of the line here. So, that's the masonry. This intrigued me, but I'm pretty sure it's common. It's just something to put in. It's just a triangle made me a bit like, hey. So anyways, I'm going to take you to this awesome murder mystery about this building. And here at BlogTO, one of my favorite sites now. I don't know, I've really been enjoying it. The Great Murder Mystery of University College. I previously recounted the story of J.P. Rudmuller, the first lighthouse keeper of Gibraltar Point, whose mysterious demise... Yeah, this is it. Led to one of the most enduring ghost stories in Toronto, tales of bumps in the night and ghostly happenings are also attached to the University of College at the University of Toronto, where two stonemasons caught in a love triangle tragically squared off more than 100 years ago. Okay, let's take in the ghostly looking picture here. I am going to quickly grab my sip of soda water. Pardon me. Okay. Strange story, guys. Music sounds about right for a strange story. So here we are, University College. This is an excellent picture, even though it's super old. You can see just like, mud flood. Raised up, they even have to mound it up, add some extra stairs. And then finally we get in, and there's all our sunken windows. But I digress. The original University College was established in 1853 out of a desire to create a place of higher education free from religious association. At the time, the only colleges in Canada were affiliated with the Church of England or Presbyterianism. So we're just going to put demon faces all over it just to, you know, make it clear that we are not Presbyterian. 3 years later, architect Frederick William Cumberland, the man behind the Toronto Street Post Office, Cathedral, Church of St. James, and Adelaide Street Courthouse, was hired to design a home for the college on what is today's University of Toronto campus. So, this is the same guy who built the St. James Cathedral, which I filmed the other day, and some other incredible works. And that's the thing. These architects, man, they did so much in their 20 years or their 25 years as an architect. Like, insane builds, year after year, overlapping one another, which is also might come up in this video, but at least in another video for sure. Okay, here we are. There's a bunch of people together. Getting ready to do what? Oh, I guess maybe it's already built there. Cumberland's plan called for an intricate stonework throughout the grand Norman Romanesque style structure, and a team of stonemasons were brought on to carve gargoyles and detailed patterns while builders worked on the main structure. Onto the worksite arrived Herculean Russian Ivan Reznikov and Paul Diablos. First of all, I'll just do a little side here. I did a bit of research. Reznikov is a Russian word. It's a very common Russian last name. It's a Russian word that means butcher. One who butchers. And Paul Diablos? Paul the devil in Spanish? So anyways, these are little holes in the stories that catch my eye. I think, that's convenient. The butcher and the devil. A man described as in Douglas Richardson's A Not Unsightly Building, University College and Its History, as pale, young, handsome, and of a subtle nature. A David and Goliath, if there ever were two. Not ever was one. The pair worked closely on the construction site, and they never seemed to see eye to eye. Well, I imagine the Spaniard was shorter. It's rumored that the wispy Diablos hated the sight of Reznikov so much that he carved his nemesis' face, more like a baboon than a man, into several of the original gargoyles that decorated the building. Reznikov, meanwhile, slaved nearby, drinking on the job from his hip flask, producing lesser quality, shaky stonework. Despite his rough appearance, the Russian was engaged to be married and had saved hard to afford the upcoming wedding. At the same time, Diablos had taken a shine to Reznikov's fiancée, Susie, and had persuaded her to elope out west with him instead, along with the Russian's savings. Oh, you devil! You devil. Okay, here we go. I'm going to make a quick little note here. We're going to maybe spend a minute doing this after because I put together some pictures. But again, we have construction pictures with a completely blotted out white sky in behind. It's almost always the way. As soon as the construction starts, white sky behind. I'm not the first person to point this out. The plan might have worked if Reznikov hadn't caught on to the plans of the conniving pair and confronted Diabolos on the deserted site one night after work. After a brief argument, deserted site, just the two of them. I don't know where they get this info. After a brief argument, Reznikov produced an axe and swung wildly at his enemy. Naturally, Diabolos backed off and fled, even though he was carrying a dagger. Soon, the furious, jilted lover had his target backed against the wooden door of the Croft chapter house. You can just see all the different camera angles. As Reznikov swung, intent on killing Diabolos, the door... It sounds better, Diabolos. I should have just said that. Diabolos. Diabolos. Yeah. The door swung open and the Russian missed his target. Oh! Put that in slow motion so I can see it again. Leaving a gouge in the woodwork that is still visible today. You can tell it's the gouge. It has Reznikov's handwriting all over it, you know? Looks just like something Reznikov would do. That butcher! Intent on landing a fatal blow, Reznikov continued the chase through scaffolds, work tools, and masonry, while Diabolos tried to elude his attacker. Bum, bum, bum! I should have put on different music for this story. Look at that. Just awesome. So good. Can we build something like that today? Let's not. At some point, Reznikov lost sight of his target and began slowly exploring the construction site. Bathed in darkness, with the moonlight glinting off the metal of his blade, it's a historical fact, the place was silent and Diabolos appeared to have escaped. Suddenly, Diabolos leapt out from the shadows, clutching his dagger and grabbed Reznikov. Yeah, he just grabbed him, that hulking Reznikov Russian. The pair collapsed into a heap, each one scrambling to land a blow. Moments later, the Russian was sprawled out, bleeding from a fatal wound to his torso. They even know he was stabbed in his torso. Panicked, Diabolos hauled the body to a hiding place somewhere in the building and fled, presumably with Reznikov's fiance, never to be heard from again. The murder would go unreported, you know, but the legend would slowly develop among students over the coming years. Aha! So, there we are with the fire. So let me get this straight. You got two guys who have pretty much been probably brought here for their stonemason skills. They're basically a couple of the two main stonemasons. David and Goliath, who visibly quarreled on the job site all the time. And one day, neither of them shows up for work. And Buddy with his fiance, Buddy's fiance is gone. And the guy who was having a tryst with her, tryst is love, yeah, that's right. He's having a romantic thing with her, he's gone too. And these guys are at the top of their game, right? They're not Joe Blow, like, down at the poorhouse masons. These are guys who have, like, they've become the top of their craft. They're like building one of the most incredible buildings in Canada. They've been hired. They're probably making a great wage. Buddy's been planning for this wedding and saving hard. He wasn't the only one planning the wedding. I'm sure he had friends and family. So why was it never reported? Why did nobody ever say, hey, Buddy's missing? Maybe because it didn't exist. But this story conveniently gets rid of the people who would explain what all these carvings were about, because they're the chief stonemasons, and now they're gone. Decades later, on February 14th, 1890, lamplighters preparing the college for building, yeah, we read that, they set fire. While picking through the smoldering remains, workers came across a human skeletal remains, reviving the old murder story. So somebody, maybe there was someone who heard the fighting, or maybe someone, maybe the murderer, maybe our friend Paul there, Diabolos, maybe he told somebody and it was this like hush-hush story. So possibly that's how the facts were told, how the light moonlight glinting off the knife was retold. The skeleton, did I finish reading that? Right. While picking through the smoldering remains, workers came across a human skeletal remains, reviving the old murder story. The skeleton was never confirmed to belong to Reznikov. Some versions of the story say a stonemason's belt buckle was found too, and the body, sometimes described as headless. Oh, ooh, was apparently buried on the college grounds nearby. Because that's what you do when you find a murdered corpse inside of a school building. You bury it in the lawn. So, guys, I know I'm being a bit, you know, silly here, but this is what they want us to believe. They're not, it's like, that's the thing. It's like, it's not, some of it, it's laughable. I can't even imagine. As you might expect, the stories like this, written more than a century after the actual event, use some poetic license. I don't know if that's an admittance of BlogTO or wherever their source is. Depending on which account you read, the personalities, physical descriptions, and circumstances of characters will vary slightly. It's impossible now to separate fact from fiction with any degree of certainty. You got any pictures of these guys? Any pictures? You got pictures of the construction? Any pictures of the people who built it? Probably not. Okay, so, very interesting. Now, where did we get this from? Where did we get this from? Well, there was one, the Dueling Stonemasons. So this guy is telling about someone who actually came up with some of the facts and how they came up with the facts. Russian stonemasons Ivan Reznikov worked on the University College, the crown jewel of U of T's collegiate Gothic architecture, during its construction in the mid-19th century. By his own admission, Reznikov was not a clever man, but he did enjoy his work. And he was betrothed to a woman named Susan, whom he loved madly. However, Reznikov's happy existence came to a brutal end late one night in 1856. So, they tell it a little bit different, not too much different, but what's kind of crazy about this story is that history might have forgotten Reznikov had a student journalist, Louis Sokolov, not resurrected the tale of the murdered stonemason in a Halloween edition of the newspaper more than two decades ago. According to Sokolov, Reznikov reappeared on a chilly, foggy evening in 1889. That night, a student was walking across campus when he encountered a tall man clad in black with lank hair spilling out from under a pointed witch-like hat. The stranger told the student that he had a story to tell. The night was cold, so they decided to talk. Oops, sorry, I lost my place there. I was looking at my computer. The night was cold, so they decided to talk in the student's resident room. There, the two finished a bottle of rum, while the ghost of Reznikov recounted how he had died so long ago. One night I stayed late, working feverishly to finish the gargoyle, he began. Oh, so he did the gargoyle. He began. I heard a girl's laugh, then Diablo's voice saying, "See the dull-witted Russian?" I crouched on the scaffolding and looked down. There below me stood Susan embracing the wily Greek Diablo. Rage gripped me, but I could do nothing. The next morning, steeled by alcohol, I attacked Diablos with a double-bladed mason's axe, like a butcher would. My first blow missed. My axe struck in a wooden door. Diablos slipped through the door, but I pursued him. He ran up the stairs and hid near an uncompleted ventilation shaft that I did not see him until it was too late. His knife plunged into my side, and then he hid my body in the shaft and said nothing about it. In the morning, the student awoke with a hangover and an empty liquor bottle in his room. His mysterious drinking buddy had vanished. 2 years later, much of University College had burned in the Great Fire, but the door with the axe wound in it can still be seen in University College southwest corner. And workers digging through the rubble discovered something strange inside a ventilation shaft, a skeleton wearing a belt with a buckle stamped with the stonemason's emblem. Bum, bum, bum. Anyway, so Mudflood Mystery North, there's a mystery for you, a murder mystery that happened. The details are a little bit funny. Don't know if I believe if any of that happened, but this is the kind of stories we're being told. That might be me, but I think it's getting a bit, my music's getting a bit loud. I'll turn that down. Hopefully that helps. So, here I was looking up Reznikov, right? Surname originates from the Ukrainian term meaning butcher, someone whose job was to kill animals for meat and prepare meat for sale. And then we all know Diablo is a Spanish word that means the devil. So, pretty cool. Lots of good pictures there. The next building I want to show you guys, which also has some interesting stuff, and that is wow, that's a terrible shot. That's a whole lot of tree. This whole area here, which is the Victoria College building, No, I did take some pictures myself, but just look at this. It's like a princess castle. This big doorway here, stairs going up. Just amazing. I walked there, and this is called Burwash Hall. So this was a residence. This is right next to that Victoria College or Victoria University, and this is like a big dining hall and student residence. It's pretty cool, but just look at the arrows here, guys. I do a video where I come and check all this out, but just amazing stuff we've come to know. So, anyways, getting on to what I want to show you. Just pull up my pictures that I took. Okay, so here I went there the other day just to get a look at it myself. Just amazing building. Of course, it's completely mud flooded. You can see that window there. And now they have, you know, it looks very quaint. It's got a lot of soft features to it. I mean, it doesn't look too, you know, menacing or anything like that.